Hi, I'm Jacob Hornberger, president of the Future of Freedom Foundation. I'm joined by Sheldon Richman, the foundation's vice president. This is The Libertarian Angle, the show, as you know, that brings you the libertarian perspective on the burning issues of the day. Sheldon, one of the burning issues is what's going on in the taxi industry worldwide. You've got this new company, Uber. Well, it's not new. It's been around for a while, but it's threatening the privileged status of a lot of taxi drivers, and they're not happy about it. They're protesting. They're going to their city councilmen, and they're trying to get Uber shut down because they're saying that their privileged position with their medallions and their license and their permits gives them the prerogative of providing taxi service to the consumers. What do you say about this?
Yeah, it's an interesting story, and there's several angles. I hope we can hit most of them or all of them today. Sure, yeah, exactly right. This is a classic case of an innovator upsetting the regulatory the sort of the regulation coddled landscape. I mean, every city's got a taxi commission, and with one or a couple of taxi companies that are embedded in the regulatory environment there. They have licenses. They're protected from competition. Rates in some ways may be regulated, and, you know, other things may be regulated, but that's clearly just in return for protection that the companies are very happy to have. They don't care about the regulation, really. Just protect them from competition, and they're just fine. So then, you get a couple of people who write an ingenious app and go out there and recruit drivers after doing criminal background checks and other forms of checking and buy massive insurance to cover so that the drivers themselves don't have to have insurance over their riders. And they set up this app, which I've used now. I used it twice on Saturday, so I know firsthand what it's like, which matches up riders and drivers in a way that's so superior to the traditional taxi company that it's not even a contest. And of course, then the taxi monopoly is worried, and so they are asking for impediments and, in some cases, outright prohibitions. I've read that Miami and Austin have now banned Uber from operating. We'll see what happens in the courts. I understand the Commonwealth of Virginia has banned it. Around the world, there have been street protests with traffic jams by taxi cab companies, and local governments have tried to put impediments in the way. For example, in Paris, they passed a law, an ordinance that said that the Uber driver must wait a mandatory 15 minutes before going to pick up the rider. When I used it the other day, the first thing you learn when you hit the app is that there's a driver 3 minutes away, and you get his name, you get a description of the model of his car and his tag number, and then you see a map with a car icon going through the streets heading toward your destination to get you. I mean, you can track his progress, and plus you can call or message him. That information is a little window you tap, and you can either call or message or cancel the ride, and he was there in 3 minutes. So a mandatory 15-minute waiting period is obviously reminds me of Kurt Vonnegut's great story, Harrison Bergeron, which was the reductio ad absurdum of, imposed egalitarianism, equality, where anybody who was faster than anybody else who could run faster had to wear leg irons. And smart people had to have something implanted in their brains so a gong would go off, at irregular intervals just to scatter the person's thoughts. Luckily, the courts in France knocked this down. But this is the sort of thing that's happening because this is, technology and innovation are upsetting. And what it's upsetting is not just other honest competition. It's upsetting a protected, regulated, either full monopoly or, virtual monopoly situation. So we're seeing it play out just the way, free market textbooks would say it would play out.
Yeah, well, let's go back to the fundamentals here. Is really, what business does the state, the city government or the county government have regulating how many taxis are on the road and how many people get to provide the service? I think fundamentally they would go back and say, well, we own the roads and the streets, and therefore we get to control the use of these things. So I think from a pure libertarian standpoint, it goes back to this debate that libertarians have been raising for a long time now is, you know, why not have private roads and private streets? But setting that aside, let's assuming that the government, you know, owns these streets and roads, the question obviously arises, is that should there be a system where, you know, just let anybody provide taxi service? And my feeling is that if the government's going to do it, then, yeah, let anybody do it. That what business does the government have providing this privileged position? I mean, I forget how much those medallions in New York City cost to run taxis, but they're enormous. I mean, in the tens of thousands of dollars to run a taxi, you got to buy a medallion totaling tens of thousands of dollars. And from what I understand, they don't give them out anymore. So they've strictly limited the supply of taxis, which obviously is going to increase prices. It's a real racket for the people that have the medallions. And so they obviously have this vested interest in trying to protect the value of their medallions. But my feeling is that, hey, you invest in a government racket, really a monopoly, a privileged position that the government's given you, and you can't cry when the consumers come and say, we don't want this monopoly anymore. We want it dismantled, that you take your chances when you buy into this medallion business. And, Uber's undercutting it. I mean, they're not going over there saying abolish the medallion system like you and I would, abolish all those licensures and so forth of taxis and, well, everyone else. They're simply saying we're going to compete. And they've circumvented the state, and I think that's what has made people very, very angry, is that they're undercutting them without playing their game of going to the legislature begging for permission to provide this taxi service.
Right. And I read that in 2012, the last figure I saw, there were fewer medallions in New York City than there were in the not late 1930s, fewer medallions. And I think they go for something like $1 million. It's an auction situation, so the price can fluctuate, but it's very, very expensive. But now there's another chapter we should in this that we should have anticipated that should be in any good free market textbook. It appears now that Uber is in bed with the regulators. Specific ride-sharing regulations are now being written at the local level. It's happening in Little Rock as I speak, where I live. And there's a big meeting today where they're going to pass an ordinance that I'm keeping an eye on. And this has been reported by Reason Magazine and other places. Uber, which a year ago apparently was criticizing the local governments for regulating, has now hired David Plouffe, who's a former Obama advisor and campaign official, to be his liaison, their liaison to the local governments. They now favor regulation and are clearly favoring the sorts of regulations that will hurt their smaller and newer competitors like Lyft. There's at least, you know, there's one or two more companies doing this. Lyft, L-Y-F-T, is a competitor. For example, in Washington, D.C., the regulation that was passed there sets a minimum age for drivers. So 18, 19, and 20-year-olds are out now. Lyft was hoping to recruit college students eager to make some money on the side, because you can work when you want to work if you're an Uber driver, but you're not employed by Uber. You're a subcontractor, or you're an independent agent. I want to say something more about the labor situation in a moment, but Uber is now helping regulators write the rules that will make it tougher on the newer competitors, because Uber's in, like you said, Uber's been around a bit. We're only just hearing about it, but it has been operating for some time now, a matter of years, and it's doing what we good free market people should predict would happen. Okay, these are not libertarians, these are not anarchists, these are not people against regulation. They're trying to make their cushy deal, and so it's a mixed story. I think in the abstract, we can be terribly excited about what a company like Uber and these other companies do. I mean, it was a fantastic experience on Saturday when I rode back and forth to and from my destination. I will say it was a little more fantastic than normal because Uber in Little Rock is not allowed to charge for its services yet because the ordinance has not been finally passed. So they've been giving away rides just as a matter of goodwill to establish their name. That makes sense. So it was free to me, not free to the driver, but because the company still pays the driver the 80% of what the fare would have been, but it was free to me, with the company eating the 20%. It was nice to have a free ride, but it would have been, of course, nice even if they were charging. So we have to keep an eye on this very closely. Uber is like a typical company in a corporate state. And somebody may say, well, what do you expect them to do? This is the environment they're in. Why shouldn't they do that? Why shouldn't they game the system? Whatever you may say about that, they're doing it. They're gaming the system. They're not different from their taxi cab monopoly competitors.
No, I mean, it's standard fare. You know, we've seen this time and time again that your average businessman is not an advocate of the free market. And he'll inevitably start looking to the government to protect his position from competition. And he won't resist it. If there's a movement afoot that's going to protect him, he'll be right there smiling. There's very few principled businessmen. I remember when I first discovered libertarianism, there was this great organization that I discovered right at the very inception when I was looking into libertarianism in the late 1970s, called the Council for a Competitive Economy.
And I worked there.
You worked there? That's right. You did work there. They were awesome. They were absolutely awesome. They were American businessmen who were purists like you and I are, you know, this uncompromising message of liberty. And these were businessmen. One of them, a guy named Bill Law, who was one of my heroes. I saw him speak at the Foundation for Economic Education. I brought him down to Laredo to do a fee seminar down in Laredo in the 70s. And Law was getting hurt. He had a tanning business, a leather tanning business in Wisconsin. He was getting hurt by imports, Japanese imports. And he took the principal position that there should be no tariffs, no import restrictions at all, despite the fact that it was adversely impacting his business. And that's the way this organization was principal businessmen that were fighting for a free market philosophy. As compared to what Uber's doing now and what most businessmen do. Most businessmen will turn to the state in order to gain their privileged position. And that's why we have all these licenses and permits and regulations and so forth. Anything to smash the little guy, the upstart, in order to maintain their market share.
No, that's right. And so it makes it hard for a libertarian to be, unconditionally enthusiastic about something. Certainly in the abstract, the business model is very exciting. I think what this is going to spawn, which I personally like very much, will be a pure peer-to-peer operation. In other words, the drivers, while they're not formally employees of Uber, are effectively employees of Uber. They don't have any stake in, or not stake so much, but no entitlement in making policy or helping to set rates. In other words, there's no legal obligation for the company to consult the drivers on anything. Now, obviously a driver can decide he doesn't want to work, be an Uber driver anymore. That's fine. He can do that. But my taste would run toward a pure peer-to-peer operation where the drivers are the owners. And the conduct by Uber that I have some objections to may actually spawn that. So, this is a moving picture. This is not a snapshot. So Uber's own activities may stimulate competition against Uber. This is one reason why we have to fight Uber attempting to have regulations written that protect its position, but make it harder for competitors. One thing that Uber does that I don't like that's gotten a lot of controversy is it has it says right on its website there's no tipping required, or, well, of course, tipping never required, but there's no expectation of tipping, they say. And they were telling telling riders in the beginning, and I've seen some riders, some drivers who've said this, they told riders, you don't need to tip, it's already in the fare. But that turns out not to be true, and now they don't say that anymore. They don't say it's not. They don't say it's in the fare. They just say it's not necessary. I mean, if it was in the fare, they wouldn't be skimming 20% off of it, because typically an employer doesn't take a portion of an employee's tip like in a restaurant. But if they're taking 20% of the total fare, that means they're taking 20% of the tip. So it doesn't sound like a tip. drivers say that their payment statements don't itemize, have an itemized line of tip. And I, in my receipts, and I got receipts even though there was no charge, I still got the receipt you would normally get. At the end, it said no charge. There was no line for tip. One of my drivers had a sign that had the Uber logo hanging from his mirror saying, tipping is not, while tipping is not required, it is appreciated. And I am sure that was a line. That's something the drivers themselves must have come up with, because I don't think Uber wants tipping even raised as an issue, as a possible expectation between driver and rider in the car. If you look at the website, it's clear that they don't, and yet here's a sign that raised the issue, and it said it's not required. Again, tipping by definition is not required, but it said it would be appreciated. So they're going to have to sort this out, because I think if the company's telling drivers, don't worry, the drivers are getting tipped, and they're not really getting tipped, I think that's not right. I don't think it's right to mislead the riders who might want to tip and then say, oh, no, I don't need to. It's already in there, when it's not already in there. So that to me, takes some of the shine off of Uber. And now this regulatory coziness, takes even more of it off. So we have to be skeptical. We have to be like Adam Smith. Adam Smith was pro-market but not pro-business. He doesn't say anything kind about business. In the Wealth of Nations, Walter Williams used to start his principles classes by saying, you can ace this course by finding me one pro-business sentence in the Wealth of Nations. And to my knowledge, he never had to give an A on that account. So we have to take the Smith stance here and be wary of businesses, because they'll jump into bed with government, you know, at the drop of a hat, and they're very happy to, and they're very happy to handicap their competition.
Well, that's why the solution is just a total free market where you just have the state playing no role in the granting of permits and licenses and medallions. And, okay, some companies might have tips. Others might prohibit tips. I mean, it's the same way that we see in other sectors of the economy. Grocery stores, you know, they don't some of them say no tipping at all. Because they don't want their customers having to deal with that. And so, but that's the beauty of the market. And we're about as far from a free market in the taxi delivery services you can get. I mean, we can celebrate these insurgent businesses that are trying to break through the medallion system. But still, you've got a massive government presence in there, which if you just freed up the market, then let the market operate. In terms of the best business model is going to be the one that's going to make the consumers happy. Let me expand the conversation a little bit. Here in Virginia, we have liquor stores, state liquor stores, which to me is pretty much on the same principle. You've got this a true monopoly here, a government monopoly that is selling liquor. And which I find very, very interesting, because the state of Virginia will be the first state to try to send somebody up for marijuana possession for, you know, the rest of his life, or cocaine or any other kind of illicit drug. And yet here is the state selling liquor, which obviously kills a lot more people than illicit drugs do. It's highly destructive. And here it is. It's a drug dealer. I mean, it is the premier drug dealer in the state. Now, they may deny that liquor is a drug, but that's just a false denial. We all know it's a drug. And so here you not only have the state as the drug dealer, it's a monopoly drug dealer. You know, it won't permit any competition. It'd be one thing if they said, okay, we're going to be one of many drug dealers selling liquor, and they open it up to competition. They won't do that. They say, we're going to be the only liquor dealer in the state, and they've got this massive statewide monopoly. And if anybody tries to compete, man, they'll go into court right away, and they will get a judge's injunction to shut him down. It seems to me that this is just perverse, Sheldon. To me, it's the same principle as these medallions and stuff, but actually even worse, because at least with the medallions, it's private businesses that are running the taxis. Here you've got the state doing it. To me, this is a real model of a monopoly.
Yeah, I don't know that that's actually worse. I would rather have the government operating. If they're going to be a monopoly taxi company, I'd rather the government do it. Let everybody see that it's government. I mean, you know, so when it's shoddy, they can blame the government. This facade of phony free enterprise, I think, is more destructive because a lot of people think, as you always point out, that we have a free enterprise system. They'll say, well, look, we have private, sure, they're regulated, but we have private companies. I'd rather the government take over the taxi cab companies if they're going to do that and let everybody see it for what it is. And speaking about, you know, I recently moved from a semi-dry county to a wet county, semi-dry meaning some restaurants could sell wine and beer and spirits by the drink. There were no package stores like you're referring to, and supermarkets weren't allowed to sell wine and beer. I now live in a county. I feel somewhat freer. I can walk into my grocery store now and actually find aisles on aisles of wine and beer, which is a nice convenience, and or I could walk around the corner and find a regular liquor store. But, of course, there are rules there, too. Only the liquor store can carry the hard liquor. That's something reserved for them. I'm sure they have lots of political clout. You can't buy hard liquor in the supermarket. That's only wine and beer.
I mean, this is so ridiculous. I mean, it seems to be treating adults as children, and I can't help but wonder how much involved here, especially on the medallion system, the taxi service is government corruption. Bribery, if not in the classic sense of payments under the table, campaign contributions, and where politicians don't want to alienate the taxi faction in town, big donors and so forth. I mean, I just can't help but believe that that's not part of what's going on here. But, you know, I find it interesting that the left is always complaining about big business, you know, big corporations and rightfully so in some instances, where the corporations do have these privileges from the government, and that's why they have their market share. But as libertarians have long argued, in a totally unhampered market economy, there's nothing wrong with a big business, because its big business, its bigness is due to the fact that it's satisfying consumers, is giving them something that they are willing to pay for. And so bigness is a sign of that you have successfully satisfied what consumers want. But yet the left never complains about these privileged positions, these great big state enterprises. The liquor industry is an example. The postal monopoly. I mean, there you've got this privileged position on a federal level. Imagine, why can't we just have a total free market in first-class mail delivery? What business does the government have delivering the mail? Why shouldn't this be entirely a private enterprise? And yet it's not. And they won't even permit competition either. They're like the state of Virginia on their liquor licenses, that only the state can furnish liquor. Well, here only the federal government can deliver the mail. And if anybody tries, and people have tried, you know, teenagers organize businesses in the inner cities to deliver mail much faster than the Postal Service. And boy, the Justice Department is in the federal court immediately getting an injunction shutting them down. And that's what we libertarians bring to the table, though. It's hey, let's think beyond where we are now. And that means let's think in terms of a genuine free market in the taxi service and the liquor business and the postal monopoly. In fact, you know, you and I have talked about licensure in the past, all kinds of licensure for lawyers, doctors, shoeshine people, hairdressers, and so forth. I mean, now we're talking about a genuine free market economy, Sheldon.
Yeah, on the issue of bigness, I think there's good reason to think that companies would not, in a truly freed market, companies would not be nearly as big as the biggest ones we see these days. I mean, Murray Rothbard in Man, Economy, and State points out that a company could get to a point where, get to the size where it itself had the same kind of calculation problems that a central planning state would have. So he says the idea of there being one big company, you know, that couldn't arise on the market because it would have the same calculational chaos that a state has. But if you have protection from competition the way that exists in the corporate state today, in other words, if you're keeping the amount of competition down and the whole just even potential competition is is less of a force than it would be, then companies will grow beyond that Rothbardian point. They'll be bigger than they would have been because they can stand to have some computational chaos if competition is suppressed by the regulatory state or the corporate state. So I think you get bigger companies. So even though there'd be some large companies, I don't think they'd be nearly as large as we see today. I think those are a creature of the corporate state.
Well, yeah, especially if you have freedom of entry where young upstart firms, I mean, I've written on this about minimum wage laws, that they really do prevent upstart companies from competing against those that are already well established. And the reason for that is that without minimum wage laws, you'd have people in the inner cities organizing new businesses and hiring people in the neighborhood for minimal wages to get the business going. But they're not able to do that. They're locked out at that initial stage, which, of course, protects the existence of the big businesses. And we've often argued as libertarians that in a genuinely unhampered market economy, with new businesses coming in, that the big businesses are under constant pressure to satisfy consumers or to continue satisfying consumers. You know, leftists are very good at arguing for redistribution of wealth through the political process. I mean, that's one of their core principles, that the state needs to take money from those who have the money and give it to those who don't. Yet, in an unhampered market economy, there is tremendous redistribution of wealth that is done simply because shifts in consumer demand. People are not satisfied with this particular consumer that yesterday was the most popular thing in the world. They immediately shift to a new computer, and causing market share to drop in the previous company. And if you went back to the top 50 firms, let's say 30 years ago, my hunch is that very few of them are in the top 50 today. And that's because even despite all the regulations and the regulated economy and all the privileges, that the market that is still left does a wonderful job of redistributing wealth in accordance with consumer demand. So you don't need the state to do this. This is all just a power and money game by the left. The market is the best redistributor of wealth and the most just because it is in response to what consumers are wanting to do with their own money.
Yeah, I agree. In a way, a little market goes a long way. It's hard to totally suppress it, even with the amount of rules and regulations and privileges that we have. Another thing that's hastening this is the erosion, really the de facto erosion, not de jure erosion, of intellectual property. With the open source software movement, what used to would have cost you thousands of dollars in software to something you could use in a business to create some good or service has fallen to free because of the open source movement, which offers highly sophisticated software that competes with Microsoft and others, and which is then given away, basically. Not only given away, but you can modify it for your own purposes, with the only condition being that you can't close it off and keep other people from having access to it. So we're seeing this implosion of capital costs for starting businesses. It first started like in the music business and the publishing business, where for a couple of thousand dollars on your desktop, you can do what used to cost tens of thousands of dollars that a person or a small operation couldn't possibly have done. Now it can be done, and that's being extended to other things. There are computer-generated machine tools now that are causing the same kind of drop, making garage operations much more feasible if the zoning doesn't get in the way and things like that. We're seeing 3D printers, which are going to enable the production of objects and things on 3D printers to become very, very cheap, so that it's going to be easier and easier for people to get into business. And that includes poor people who are just totally corrupted by the system and basically raped by the system. And so the system gives them some crumbs, a little bit of money, some food stamps, as a way to ease their pain, which has been caused by the system to begin with. You know, it's the old idea of the state breaks people's knees and then looks good handing out the crutches. That's what's going on. But so this technological revolution and this getting around intellectual property is is making it possible for low-income people to say to the state, we don't need you. Stop it. Leave us alone. We can start a business now. But is the minimum wage going to get in the way? Zoning, licensing? Yes, but people will find ways around that. And we that's where we need to really be making a huge fuss.
Yeah, the when you see breakthroughs like this around the regulations and so forth, it's encouraging. But it's not the ideal. It's not the free society. It's not the free market. I mean, the free market is a separation of economy and the state, the same way that our ancestors separated religious activity in the state. And just as we don't allow the government to regulate religious activity, we shouldn't be allowing the government to regulate economic activity. And it boggles the mind as to how fantastic things would be if we didn't have to do with all this privilege, licensure, permits, monopolies, and so forth. That's it for the show. I want to remind those of you that watch this program that this is our end-of-year fundraising time. We genuinely need your support. The money that we raise at this time pretty much funds our operations for the coming year. We need your support to underwrite these types of programs and other things that we do here at the Future of Freedom Foundation. And our objective here is to present this uncompromising, pure message of liberty. That's been our mission since 1989 when we first got established. So that's what we strive to do. And we strive to do that with our op-eds, our articles, our blogs, our conferences, our speeches, all across the board. But we need your help to fund the spreading of these ideas. Now, we believe that if we can get these ideas into the marketplace, they will have an impact. And that's the only way that we can have an impact. If people don't consider the ideas of liberty, this idea of separating the economy and the state, getting the government out of our economic activity, then how are they ever going to conceive of that idea? It's very unlikely they're going to do so on their own. So that's the partnership. We present the ideas, but we need your support to get them into the marketplace of ideas. And that's how we bring this shift toward a free society that we think is possible. So thank you so much. And that's the show. We'll see you next week.